Hello and welcome to Ask GC Anything. It's that time of the week when we go through your questions all about cycling.
Now, if you'd like to leave a question for next week, then use the hashtag Torqueback and leave your question in the comments below. And if you'd like to ask a training specific question, then use the hashtag AskGCNTraining.
So we've got a question from Ben Hinks. I live in the hills and want to get better at sprinting and riding fast on flat roads. Is there any way I could do this on hills? Well, the answer, Ben, is yes. We actually spoke to Chris Opie, who's our resident sprinter, and he said that what you want to do is look at doing about 6 efforts of around 12 seconds uphill, and that'll work on your power. And then you can also do the same effort going downhill, and that'll work on your cadence. So basically you're working on your speed and your power, which ultimately will give you a fast sprint.
Yep, so basically it's the effort that counts, and you can use a hill, just have to use it wisely. You can actually also check out Chris's excellent how to sprint video.
Maintaining that really strong anchor point at the front of the bike. Are you ready for this side?
Yeah.
Come on then.
Right, now we come to our special Zwift section where the lucky questioner gets 3 months of free Zwift subscription in return for their excellent question. You can submit your questions using the hashtag AskGCNTraining.
So the lucky winner this week was Frederick J. Gomeringa Jr. I think that's how you pronounce your name. I apologise if not. Is there a way to train for endurance while being time crunched? So basically, what I'm asking is there a way to substitute a training method to increase endurance without riding longer? Or is riding longer and more often the only way to increase one's endurance? Well, I don't know if you want to start. Do you want to start with that one?
Yeah, well, I think it's an excellent question for both time-crunched and professional athletes, because when athletes talk about increasing endurance, they normally mean about increasing their aerobic efficiency. And traditionally, in the good old days, this was done by just doing really, really long rides, like with, you know, just water and no food. But that is old school, and it's not very time efficient for anyone. And I think these days, even professional athletes who have more time to train would do things a little bit differently. So we did chat with Zwift about this, and so basically, the more efficient you are at processing fat and carbohydrate aerobically, the higher your sustainable power. So that means you can produce more power for fewer heartbeats, basically. So how do we do that? Well, we did talk with Zwift about this, and we got some suggestions for sessions, and here we go.
So do a repeated session, so 30 seconds at a VO2 max intensity, so around 106 to 120% of your FTP, with 3 minutes in recovery. So remember that 3 minutes, because you're gonna need it. And you know, you wanna do around 20,
Up to 20
of these, yeah. These efforts would be a really effective session.
Yeah, and the key point is that although the intensity is VO2 max, the effort only would target your VO2 max system if you did the interval for longer than 3 minutes. So if you do like a shorter interval, so 30 seconds up to 2 minutes, while it's at VO2 intensity, it won't really be training your VO2 max system because you won't have reached VO2 max. Mm. And so what it does do really well is train your aerobic capacity. You should feel your breathing rate increase towards the end of the effort to cope with the load, but it shouldn't be a sprint. So you want to hold it nice and steady for the 30 seconds to 2 minutes, however long you're doing it for.
So a few key performing, tips to perform the training is riding with a high cadence for the interval portion. This is an aerobic effort, so that maintaining a high cadence really improves the aerobic stimulus. And also, the intervals are not maximal efforts, so remember that. They are nice and controlled efforts with stable power produced, yeah.
Yeah, and so if you wanted to progress the session, when you start out, you could do, for example, 10 times 30 seconds hard with 3 minutes recovery. And then as you progress and you get stronger, you could build it up to 20 times 1 minute with just 2 minutes recovery. So don't start out with the hardest version. I'd start out with the easy version and progress.
Yeah, and these can all be done out on the road, but it is a lot easier to do it inside and on Zwift, because then you can really get clear.
Yeah. You've got no excuses, because out on the road, there's always a traffic light or a hill or a downhill or a pothole. So on a trainer, is really, well, time efficient, but also you know exactly that you're going to produce the right power. So it's quite
and
a good
also,
one.
And also, you can just sit at a certain power, can't you? On there, you see what power you're sitting at. You can sit there. It's easy to do. It's there. Yeah. No excuses.
Yeah, I found personally with Zwift that psychologically, physically it was hard, but psychologically it was easier because it would apply the power and I just had to do it. So exactly. I didn't have to decide to produce 250 watts.
Nope.
I had no choice, or I stopped pedaling because I couldn't do it. Right, the next question is from Eli Chris Brown and he asks, is there a maximum size a brake group can be before it is no longer regarded as a brake? Say if there are more riders in the brake than in the peloton itself, which group is actually the peloton? And how big does the brake need to get to before the aerodynamic advantage of the peloton to be negated, assuming the brake collaborates? Well, that is a very complicated question, but we love it.
I mean, it is a great question, and it did get a lot of chat in the office, I have to say.
Yeah, we think basically that the peloton is where the GC riders are. So if the GC riders stay behind, and a big group goes up the road, it's still a break, we reckoned.
Yes, so basically, you know, a race is split up into three parts normally. So you've got the breakaway at the front, and the breakaway is getting away from the peloton, which is the main GC riders. And then the guys that are falling out the peloton...
Out the back,
is known as the gruppetto. So basically, you want to kind of... It's a difficult one because there's no right or wrong answer, but I would say the peloton is the racers that are still racing, and the breakaway is the racers that are getting away from that group.
And then we come to the aerodynamics question, which I thought was a really good question. And that is actually the subject of ongoing research. So I had a bit of a look, and it turns out that Bert Blocken at Eindhoven University of Technology has recently started doing research in a wind tunnel with really large groups of cyclists. So previously, we already knew that a group of cyclists, obviously, you save energy if you're behind someone. And previously, it was thought that you saved 50 to 70% of energy by riding in a group. But Bert Blocken at Eindhoven has found that with 121 model cyclists in a wind tunnel, if you're right at the back, you're actually only using 5 to 7% of the energy.
Big saving.
Yeah, exactly, which is why riders who are good at riding in the peloton save so much energy. So that means that obviously the bigger group, you get more of an advantage, but how big the group has to be to get that big advantage, we don't know. We'll have to ask Dr. or Professor Blocken, I think.
More research is needed.
Yes,
yeah.
But fascinating question, thanks. The next question comes in from Fleinsop Mannen.
How do I know when to buy a new bike? I'm pretty new at cycling, especially road biking, but I feel that my road bike is a bit too small for me. I don't know if I should try to ride it for a bit longer before I invest in a new gear. I personally would say get down to your local bike shop and get a bike fit. I think once you know black and white what your measurements are, and then you'll know exactly if your old bike fits or if it doesn't fit. I mean, I know you did a video on this not too long ago.
Yep, you could check out this video of my bike fit with Shimano, which was really interesting to me, even though I have actually obviously been racing and riding for years and years. Just the details of how a bike fit happens and what's important to look at in your own bike fit. And I think that especially if you're new in cycling, that'll really help you to be sure that bikes, the frame's at least the right size, and to avoid injury potential, which you don't want to get injured, obviously.
You definitely don't want those problems.
And even if your bike does fit you currently, it'll give you peace of mind and knowing that it's okay.
Yeah, there you have it. So the next question is from Sajmon495. What's the newest approach to stretching / rolling straight after the exercise? Heard an opinion that might actually develop muscle damage already done by the training, or is it better to do it a few hours later? For example, at the end of the day. Well, I personally would get in from ride and then I'd straight away stretch, and then I'd kind of work on recovery, shower, change, chill out for a bit. And then if I have still some kind of like knots and stuff that I kind of want to iron out, I'd jump on the roller. And what's your kind of opinion on that?
Well, I don't like doing my stretching straight after riding because the first thing I want to do is get showered and fed. Normally I'm quite hungry, so yeah. That's a priority. Otherwise I'm hangry, and hangry stretching is bad stretching.
We don't want hangry, Emma.
No, bad. But basically, I have to say I was pretty lax about stretching because there's no scientific evidence to show that stretching reduces your injury risk or indeed makes you more flexible. And I'm not saying that you shouldn't do it because I do still sometimes stretch. It makes me feel better. It's quite relaxing. It can make you feel more relaxed. But personally, I would do any stretching or core work either before, well, I'd do my core work before the ride, I'd do stretching in the evening when I'm clean and fed.
Mm.
So there
good
you go.
Point. So the next question is from Chip Thompson. Does regular donation of blood components, platelets and plasma have any impact on fitness? Thanks from Northern California.
I mean, it's clear that if you lose red blood cells, your performance will will reduce. Whether or not you can feel it's a different matter. So I think that's why the jury's out in some cases. But but certainly the fact that people used to dope by adding red blood cells would indicate that losing red blood cells is not great for your performance.
Decrease,
And although your blood plasma volume will return to normal within 24 hours, it'll take weeks for your red blood cell count to go back up, and longer possibly if you're vegetarian. And I actually have anecdotal evidence, because when I was a student, I gave blood right until my early 20s, and I noticed it one week when I was running in the summer, and I did a track session the week before and a track session the week after donating blood, and the difference in my 800 times just doing reps was huge, like 20%. And I was the same effort, and there weren't any other real major factors that were different. And it was a real eye-opener. So since then, I have not donated blood in the race season.
No, and I'd probably advise the same, wouldn't you?
Yeah, definitely, because it will affect your performance. But good on you for being a blood donor. That's a freaking brilliant thing to do. And just maybe think about your targets. Right, the next question comes in from Jens Digman, who asks, "Hi, GCN. I was just wondering if you think that foam inner tubes, like the Ultra Boost Sole, shoe sole, is the future of inner tubes. Will we maybe see them in the Tour de France peloton in a few years' time, or is it a gimmick? I think the concept is very cool, but I haven't tried them yet, so I don't really know how efficient they are. And also, do you guys fancy football? And if so, do you support any team? I've always wanted to know."
Do you support a football team?
No, I'll be honest, I'm not hugely into football, but I'm from Norwich, so by default, I'm a Norwich City supporter, especially when they're playing Ipswich Town, who are our arch rivals.
And I, when I was younger, I did get the chance to go and visit the Chelsea football ground, where I met Gianfranco Zola, if that's how you pronounce it. So I kind of started following Chelsea, but now I'm just full gas cycling.
Anyway, there you go. Anyway, to the real question.
To the question.
What do you reckon?
Tubeless. I personally ride tubeless on my road bike, and I do think it is amazing. You don't have to bring a pump, an inner tube. You don't have to worry about puncturing. And you don't have to worry about kind of those really annoying, like, pinch punches.
Yeah.
That, so you can ride at lower pressures and not worry about the pinch punches. So I think that's where we're going.
And what do you think about this foam? To me, that's quite new to me. So I'm not
convinced personally.
No, but then I thought that about tubeless, I thought that sounded like a terrible mess with all that sealant.
And suddenly they're
and
everywhere.
And now they're everywhere, and I used them last year and loved them. So I reckon, I'm going to gamble and say, I think foam is the way to go.
I reckon tubeless.
Yeah.
So, jury's
out.
What's
his space?
Yeah. Next question is from Emily. What's the easiest way to clean chain rings without removing them?
Elbow grease, Emily. Elbow grease.
Yeah.
And degreaser.
I think degreaser is the main one here. So, what I would do is I'd get in from your ride, and when you want to clean your bike, get it on a stand or whatever, spray as much degreaser on the chain rings as you think you need.
And or you can use a paintbrush dunked in degreaser and...
Yeah. Exactly. And then just kind of like spread it around the chain rings, and then get a kind of a wire brush or kind of a relatively hard brush, and just kind of scrub the rings, and then just get a hose. And that normally comes pretty clean.
Yeah. The thing you have to remember, obviously, is you have to also clean the chain, because if your chain rings are dirty, either your chain made them dirty or your chain rings made the chain dirty. So if you don't clean the chain as well, they will just get dirty again straight away. So clean your chain, and I'm sure we have lots of videos on cleaning chains. So clean your chain, and then make sure you lube it afterwards, or it'll go rusty and squeaky, which is horrible.
Yeah, and it's horrible riding with no greaser on your chain, so make sure you do lubricate it back up.
Now the next question comes from Ewan Gray, who asks, "I recently got a new gravel bike, and every time I go out on longer rides, I get neck pain. Is there any way to avoid this? What do you reckon?" I think that if you've got a new bike, and you're used to riding on your old bike, but you don't get neck pain on the old bike, then it does seem to indicate there's something about the new bike's position that is giving you neck pain. Or it's the bumpiness of the gravel, potentially. But it might be worth comparing the positions.
I would definitely look at your position, because it might mean that you're a bit too lower than you're used to. So you're looking up, and that's when you kind of get a bit of a sore neck.
Yeah, you crick your neck. So the drop to your handlebars is too much. So.
But I used to always, when I started racing, so I'd always training on the tops, and then I'd start racing, I'd sit on the drops for 4 hours, and then I'd get neck pain.
Yeah.
So that's just because you're kind of not used to it.
Yeah, so exactly. So train it in the position, and you might get used to it.
Yeah. But if not, just kind of adapt the position.
To be more similar to your old bike, where you don't get neck pain.
Exactly.
Next question comes in from James Webster, who asks, "How do you remove old sealant from a tyre? I have a tyre with good tread and a bunch of dry sealant. I've been using my thumbs to rub off the sealant, but I have removed the skin from my thumbs. Don't laugh. Well, I confess that I've never removed sealant from a tyre. What do you do, James?
Is that because you keep having all your kind of pro mechanics? Is that what it is?
Well, I didn't use tubulars.
World champ over here.
When I used tubulars, yeah, I had a mechanic, and now I don't use them too.
So I have come and had this problem. And like you, I was scrubbing away and still couldn't get off. But what I used was a wire brush. So if you just want to get a wire brush and just scrape the inside of the tyre, that normally helps it loosen off. All kind of like people have used Windex to kind of loosen it off.
Yeah.
But yeah, just use a bit of elbow grease and scrub. Yeah.
So if you use any kind of soap basically or Windex, you want to be sure that it's not nothing that will damage the rubber compound, because obviously then you'll ruin the tyre. So don't use anything too harsh.
Yeah.
Or you might end up knackering the tyre anyway.
Just get a good brush.
Scrub. Next question comes in from Luis Solagui. Who asks, I just broke my collarbone in an accident and I won't be able to ride for some time. Sorry. Is there any way to decrease muscle loss and or maintain aerobic condition while I heal? Well, sorry to hear about your injury, Luis.
There is. I mean, there's plenty out there, because this is the most common cycling injury. You only have to do a little bit of Googling to find out all different kinds of ways. But I've personally never, touched wood, broke my collarbone. But a lot of friends have, and what they've used is they've kind of spun their bars round, so they're a bit higher, so you're sitting a bit higher, so you're not putting so much pressure on the collarbone, and jumped on the turbo, because you can do, you know, the same amount of efforts on the turbo, and you just have to kind of sit there for longer.
Yeah, it's a super effective training tool, the turbo trainer, so it's maybe not as fun as going out for a ride with your friends on the road, but you can definitely maintain your fitness. It's just that you have to be bit disciplined and sit on the turbo. But with modern training tools like Zwift, frankly, it makes training on the turbo so much more fun.
Yeah.
So when I broke my collarbone, I was just on the balcony on a turbo trainer. And of course, a lot of pros who break their collarbones get back racing very, very quickly. For example, you were mentioning...
Matthew Heyman, who kind of rode for Orica Greenwich back then, he broke his arm or collarbone or something. And he actually used a stepladder to kind of get back on the turbo and kind of lift his weight off. And yeah, he went and won Paris-Roubaix. So
straight afterwards, after all his training on the turbo.
It can be done.
Yeah, it can be done, and you have no excuses now for not winning Roubaix after your broken collarbone. Sorry. But best of luck for your recovery, and let us know how it goes on.
So, thanks for watching. I hope we've answered all your questions, and I hope you've enjoyed watching this video. So if you have, give us a thumbs up.
Yep, and you might also like to check out the shop where you can buy these lovely yellow Tour de France t-shirts.
We love them.
We do love them. I like them. I feel quite sunny in this t-shirt.
Yours needs an iron, Emma. But
Other
than that, it's all good. No, thank you for watching. And
give us a like.
Give us a like. And look out for next week's.